I think we're going to have a very robust discussion here at a really exciting time to be looking into the future. Today is the opening day of Hudson Yards, which is a gargantuan feat of engineering and planning, and is, you know, kind of a symbol of how New York always looks to its future. And our panelists here are leaders in shaping this built environment with the exhilarating challenge of kind of looking beyond the day-to-day and seeing what can come on the horizon and figuring out a path there beyond the current budget constraints, beyond the kind of challenges and noise that happen in the political hurly-burly that is building New York. So I'm hoping that for this hour we can really look toward that future and find a think about what the successful path forward will look like to a city that is going to be going well beyond a population of 9 million by 2040. So I'll start with a question for all the panelists, which is, how are we as a city going to make room for our growing population while keeping the city livable and vibrant? And how are you each doing your part? So I'll start with you, Sarah.
Okay, so, you know, I think that historic preservation, I think, has become kind of a norm in this city, and it's a very exciting time to be involved in this work. I think that it's the combination of historic fabric and new construction together that make the city so dynamic. And you know, the city continues to change. The one constant about the city is change. And I think preservation, in a way, is also a very forward-thinking discipline. It's about the future. It's about thinking about what resources are important to protect going forward. And as we move forward in time, our perspective changes. And it's also about once we have designated properties, how they continue to grow and adapt and meet the needs of future growth and keeping the city dynamic. And so I think, you know, there are New York right now, there are only about 3.3% of the buildings and sites in this city are designated. So I definitely think that there's room for more, but I think this is sort of a twofold approach. We constantly are thinking about how buildings can continue to adapt and embrace new and grow and remain vital and relevant in the future. And secondly, as we look toward the sort of larger goals of the city, we work very closely with our sister agencies, and in particular with the City Planning Commission. So as they look at areas to rezone for growth, we partner with them to find opportunities for preservation, so preservation and planning can work together and contribute to that vitality.
So at the Transit Innovation Partnership, where we work very closely with the MTA, we know that that transit is deeply connected to equity and to opening up other areas where people live. So, for example, before the public transit system and the subways were introduced, a huge areas of Queens were rural, and by introducing public transit, it became a destination for people to move. So there's that historical foundation. When we look now at how do we accommodate growing numbers of people, and how do we accommodate for those populations and make sure that they have the access that they need, we know first that it's becoming more and more expensive to live in the near to the central business district, which everyone knows. But we also know that public transit overwhelmingly serves lower income New Yorkers, and the further out you are from that central business district, you're disproportionately affected by delays and quality of life impacts from public transit, from poor performances of public transit. So we're focused on improving the customer experience and the performance of the system through various public-private partnerships. One of our most recent is through the launch of something called the Transit Tech Lab, which is an accelerator for startups that are helping to solve these problems with the MTA. We actually just kicked off a couple of weeks ago, and it's been very exciting to see some of the most innovative companies in the world. We had almost 100 apply for the chance to work with the MTA, working with subject matter experts from the MTA and hearing things like, we need you, you're going to bring us into the 21st century. using technology to improve those things. So that's just one way that we're looking at it. And then as I think further, there's so many developments that will be happening in transit. And one of, for example, autonomous vehicles comes up a lot as something that will drive more populations to be living even further out, and all of the repercussions there. So obviously the links between transit and housing and where people work are intrinsic.
Well, that's a perfect segue, because I would want to address two facets of it. One is housing, and then the second is the livability. On the housing, we're addressing it in a couple of dimensions. In much of the country, it's very trendy to talk about transit-oriented development. We don't use that term in New York City because it's just what we do, it's inherent. But we are re-looking at our transit lines. Historically, one would have thought you don't want to live adjacent to an elevated subway line. And if you look at our zoning, it is generally zoned for low-scale manufacturing. Well, if you fast forward from 1961, when our zoning, the last comprehensive rewrite, building technology has changed. So it is absolutely fine to live directly adjacent to an elevated subway line, which by definition means you're close to mass transit. So that's one way. A second is we're looking at different ways of housing people. Micro units, co-living, and co-living not just for kids just out of school, but also for seniors as a different housing model. We're exploring whether it makes sense in a new world of manufacturing, and particularly light manufacturing, which doesn't have the noxious fumes, to think about not just mixed commercial and residential, which is a norm in New York City, but possibly mixed commercial, industrial, and residential models. And then finally, and this again goes very much to what you're doing in your partnership, is we're thinking about the solution regionally, which is New York City can't address its housing needs just within the boundaries of the city. There is a very healthy ecosystem of jobs and housing that exists throughout the 31 county greater New York City metropolitan area. On the livability side of it, I think one of the key things we've done and are continuing to do is rediscover our waterfront. It is an amenity that in the past made New York City great because it was the harbor, we were the manufacturing capital, but the fact that we have taken the decaying Port Authority piers and turned them into Brooklyn Bridge Park, the fact that we've recaptured through Hudson River Park, the same is occurring along the Brooklyn, the Queens, the Bronx waterfront. This is a way that we're increasing the amenity of the city.
Well, Marisa, you really started already to, I think, answer the next question I'm going to ask, but I feel like we can take it even further, which is to say that as land becomes a kind of scarcer commodity in the city, are there ways that technology and innovation and just kind of creative planning can help New York City think about different ways of using the resources around us that aren't simply the land as we've traditionally understood it?
What I think is interesting is that zoning was first adopted to address concerns about buildings that blocked the light and air. The City Planning Commission is headquartered in the old Equitable Life Building at 120 Broadway. This building is on the Federal Register, it's an individual landmark. It is a beloved building. But when it was built in 1913 or so, it rises 40 stories, full block, sheer from the street. And neighboring landowners were horrified that this building was blocking their light and air. And it led to the first zoning resolution, the New York City zoning resolution of 1916. And so now you fast forward, and it's this beloved landmark. What I think is interesting is the same concerns about light and air are still very much present today. I think a lot about the air as the next frontier of the public realm. Historically, when we thought about the air, it is about sunlight, or it's about the FAA and making sure that the air way high up is clear. But with the advent of drones, I think we need to start thinking about how do we feel about drones delivering to your 10th floor apartment? What is public? What is private? How do we control it? And when you think about light, light traditionally was access to sunlight. I think now we're facing a different light challenge, which is the screen challenge. If you go to Times Square, you expect to see a lot of pulsing screens, but do you expect it in every central business district, in every retail district, in a residential neighborhood? Do you expect it on the new signs on the subway platforms? What if the signs within the cars were also pulsating? What if they had sound? And so I do think technology is forcing us to confront a new definition and new challenges in protecting the public realm.
Yeah, I mean, what is this? I mean, there are a lot of implications for preservation as well, and in fact, opportunities to think about how do you use, you know, the opportunities that exist in the air, and thinking about planning and density as ways of both furthering preservation and transit, which we've seen some inroads on in the Midtown East rezoning, where there was a lot of good thinking. But where do we take that from there to think about how can you enhance those other qualities that are so important for running the city?
Yeah, and I think the interesting thing about technology also is that historically this is how, you know, buildings have evolved because of innovations in technology. So I think that will continue to happen, and as our technology changes, our construction methodologies change, and our building typologies, our program needs, if things are going to be delivered by air, what does that mean for entrances and openings, and how do facades get articulated? So I think the expression, architectural expression, sort of is a reflection of these changes in technology. And so I think the interesting thing about preservation and looking forward is being able to kind of identify these sort of future markers of these milestones. And so, you know, for example, the cast iron, Soho Cast Iron Historic District, we have designated that it's the largest collection of cast iron buildings in the country, but that was a very specific innovative technology at the time, and the Equitable Building. And so I think, you know, looking at what are the really important milestones, and then what are the ones that are not so important, and how do you be selective about that? And so I think that's something interesting to think about as a preservationist looking forward. How do you sort of identify these in advance, make sure that you sort of protect the best, and leave room for continued change.
And just to sort of complement the innovation in the hardware, if you can call it that, in the physical realm, there's a lot of talk, of course, about, I'm not a huge fan of the term smart cities, because it seems like everything gets thrown into that bucket. But there is this promise of, we as a city produce an enormous amount of data. And before I was in this role, I worked at the city and the state. And especially, you know, speaking to New York, we are producing this data and sometimes archiving and using this data on systems that are very old, that are legacy systems, that are not digitized, that are not easy to parse and use and get insights out of. But that's where the opportunity is. And the ability to use to pull together all of this data that we know exists and to apply it for both planning and operations are very exciting. And so this is something we have conversations about constantly at the MTA, for example, where there are enormous opportunities to improve service through the use of more data, through the use of existing data. One of our relevant transit tech lab companies, for example, is called Remix, and it can be used to dynamically plan things like bus routes. But while you do it, it also pulls in various public data sources such as census information, demographic information, climate-related information around resiliency, so that you can understand here's the population that will be served by this line. Here's the impacts and the, you know, how this intersects with mitigation efforts around the climate. So it brings this element, and not to mention it is so much faster because it's digital, and everyone's able to very quickly mock up these potential future routes when you're looking at a system they've already made the commitment to redesign the bus network, for example, in all five boroughs. So that's one small example of here's how our cities can get smarter, but of course in practice it is so much more difficult because we have legacy systems, we have regulations, et cetera. But the sort of dream is that all of these different systems can come together so that everything can be more holistic and efficient.
I mean, and you're talking about transit in, you know, as the MTA currently runs it, is very much in the traditional model of of mass transit with, you know, schedules and routes, the kinds of things you're talking about. But we are also are, as one of the panelists mentioned, you know, entering an age of micro-mobility, right, where you have self-driving cars on the horizon, you have other modes. We already have people using, you know, Uber and other e-hail technologies to really, it's really rapidly changing the nature of how people get around. So how, you know, it especially I think for you, Rachel, I mean, how do you factor that into thinking about how, you know, the MTA is not gonna and shouldn't rip up the subways, but how is it going to actually evolve to be relevant in a transit world where people are micro-mobilizing?
Well, it's a very exciting question. And one of the things we try to look at is there is an explosion in investment in the mobility sector. And often the default stance is to say that that's antagonistic to public transit, but there are so many applications of these technologies that are being funded. The research is being funded by the private sector because they have these private sector applications that can be applied to public transit. And things like sensor technologies, something that makes a car smarter and more aware and is the underlying technology of autonomous vehicles, can do the same thing for a bus and a train. Not even yet talking about making those things autonomous, but it's an extremely hazardous profession. There's every day many risks. So making that safer for passengers, for customers, for New Yorkers, as well as for the very hardworking people at the MTA, those are the types of things that are very exciting to us. When we think about autonomous vehicles, we don't know what we don't know, and it's very difficult. You know, it's on the one hand, you have people saying this is going to be, it's the utopia, and we won't need private car ownership, and so there will be less traffic. On the other hand, another reason not to rip up those tunnels is because you really can't, especially in New York, you can't match the throughput of the transit system when it comes to the number of people who are moved by a train. So you have an express, 4 or 5, 6 train, or 4 or 5 train that can carry, a full train can carry something like 2,000 people. In cars, even fully occupied cars, you're not gonna get anywhere close to that, and with the projected cost of autonomous vehicles being close to pennies on the dollar because the labor costs are removed, the financial incentive is gone. And so we still need to find ways to support transit. I think one other interesting thing that I've begun to see research around is the ability for public transit to be more dynamic and flexible. So as we know, as we see demand rise, we can respond to that. And things like, they have buzzwordy names like modular autonomous vehicles. Like, imagine if your bus could get larger or smaller in a pod-like system to respond to exactly where demand is. So this, I think cities are going to have to be very thoughtful about this. There's also, repercussions, like we have over $1 billion a year in parking and traffic fines. If the cars are so smart that they never do those, where does that come from? And we need different modes. So there's so many exciting challenges to look for.
If maybe I could pick up on that, it's appropriate that we're here on very close to the 30th anniversary of the internet. And it's hard to imagine that 30 years ago, only those who were in academia at Stanford, MIT, knew what they were working on. And I feel as if we're at that same type of inflection point with autonomous vehicles and possibly other technologies that aren't yet out in the public realm yet. When we think about mobility, it's interesting to think about the evolution, right? It started with roads, and you thought about the grid system, the road grid system throughout the city. It then evolved, and another way of thinking about connectivity in the city is via the subway system. We now have a sixth borough, which is the Blue Borough, which is our water connections. We are fundamentally rethinking what is close to what, how you get from here to there, because the water is now a viable option. That has ramifications for how we use other modes of transit. If you think about the fact that as a tight city, we have competition for our sidewalks. In the past, what was on the sidewalks? Fire call boxes, blue post office boxes, phone booths. I look at you, Alyssa, at the Daily News, the Daily Planet, where you had those phone booths where Superman could change. Those, You had actually newspaper boxes where you would buy your newspaper. None of that is competing on the streets anymore. Even parking meters have gone from a whole bunch of little ones to centralized facilities, but we do have to think about how do we need to evolve further? How do we provide the charging stations for the electric vehicles? And so even though the sidewalks remain the same, how we use them has fundamentally changed thanks to technology.
You talked about water, and water can be a friend and it can also be a foe when we have an era of climate change and sea level rise. And just yesterday, Mayor de Blasio announced a rather bold proposal to extend the land of Lower Manhattan out as a barrier to prevent seas from inundating parts of Lower Manhattan. And it leads me to want to ask you how each of you factors in resiliency and climate change into your work and how you see that actually withstanding conditions in 2040.
Yeah, well, I think, you know, climate change and need for resilient approaches is a reality. It's a reality today, and it's just going to become more of a reality. And so I think, you know, we at the Landmarks Commission, I think, are always and have been for a long time trying to think about how we make that bridge between preservation and resiliency and meet those needs. And, you know, I would say that about 700 properties are in the current 100-year flood zone. And so that's primarily Lower Manhattan, the South Street Seaport, Tribeca North, Chelsea West, Dumbo. And, you know, so I think for those particular areas today, we are able to accommodate a lot of resilient approaches. So things like solar panels, raising mechanical equipment up out of the flood zone, flood barriers, and even passive house type approaches and high performance approaches to historic buildings, we've been incorporating into our regulatory framework so that we can approve all of those very easily. But even looking forward at future designations, so for example, last year we designated the Coney Island Boardwalk, and in doing so, we recognized its relationship to the waterline, its coastal environment, and in that designation, we sort of celebrated that, but also laid out a statement of regulatory intent that recognized that there would be need for change in the future, maybe even replacement, because of its proximity to the waterfront. And so I think that's the next thing, is thinking about, you know, future landmarks that may be near areas that would be affected by climate change, and how do you prepare for that? How do you prepare for that loss and damage and build that into your flexibility for the future?
So on, obviously, you only have to look at Hurricane Sandy to see the impacts of climate change on the subway system and how severe it can be. And even recently, we're still dealing with those repercussions with the most recent, you know, the new L-train plan and bringing in different types of experts and trying to find a way to mitigate this quickly with the least impact on the public. So the MTA has to be very focused on it. But I'll speak a little bit more on sort of the emissions reduction side of the equation, because we are more involved in that. And just on two fronts, it really speaks to the need for more renewable energy sources. So the subway system is already the biggest, Con Ed's biggest customer in New York City. It runs on electricity, as you know. And to the extent that we can encourage more renewable energy sources, then it becomes greener and greener. On the bus side, there anything that we can do to help buses move more quickly and efficiently, to be idling less. Obviously, there's a commitment to have all electric buses. In the interim, we're looking at measures to help to speed the buses through the city. Right now, the bus speeds are around 7 miles per hour and sometimes slower than walking, and ridership is going down as a result. That's not only bad for customer experience, but it's not a positive thing for the emissions. It's not an efficient way to operate. So just a couple of technologies that we've looked at. Two are really looking at how do we improve bus lane enforcement. We do have bus lanes, and if they can be more effective, then the buses can move more quickly and they can move more people, and it's this virtuous cycle. So we're looking at technologies that can identify bus lane obstructions to help with enforcement and deterrence, but also to understand here's an intersection where a bus is frequently waiting. There's new technologies they can implement called transit signal priority, where the bus can move before the other vehicles. So relatively inexpensive changes like that can have a huge impact. Another one is predictive maintenance on vehicles. So the buses, New York City's buses produce an enormous amount of data that's very valuable. So one of the companies that we're working with at the Transit Tech Lab analyzes that data, and they have technology that can help to predict before the check engine light goes on a bus, before there will be a problem. And this means that the bus is not only not going out of service and disrupting service, but it's you could end up destroying an engine, destroying the system, and as a result of this technology, we help to mitigate that. So I think it really speaks to the importance of both moving to that electric grid, having those renewable models, renewable energy sources, but in the interim, trying to make it as efficient as possible.
I want to give a few stats just to dimension how big a challenge this is. If we look today at the number of people who live in a federal flood zone, it's 400,000. That's the size of Minneapolis. If we go to the 2050 projections, it will double to 800,000. There are only a handful of US cities that are larger than 800,000 people. And so it is part of everything we do at city planning to think about resiliency. One of the initiatives that we have underway is a citywide resiliency zoning initiative. And doing anything citywide in a city this big is challenging, but well worth it. And what we realized is that our zoning currently contains disincentives to make your home resilient. And so we are proposing that this doesn't pertain in Manhattan where we are here. Think about portions of Queens, coastal southeastern Queens, 1 in 2 family homes. If you no longer want to keep your bedrooms in a flooding basement, the proposal is you can go up the extra 10 feet. You can move your generators up into higher side yards. Just simple ways of getting the zoning out of the way of allowing homeowners to become more resilient. And turning to Rachel's technology tools, one thing we do extraordinarily well at the Department of City Planning is mapping and data visualization, because as important as having the facts is displaying them in a way that is visceral, that people get. And so we're very proud of our flood zone mapper. For any area of the city, you can identify your property, see where it is relative to today's flood zone, 2030, 2050, and that is an important planning tool, and it's absolutely free.
Okay, we have questions from the audience. Today, we see a lot of empty apartments. How can the city address this as you look to the future? Vacant apartments. I think meaning apartments that are owned but not occupied, as opposed to abandoned, which was the state of affairs a few decades ago. Now they are owned by people who do not occupy them.
Right.
I would note that the city's vacancy rate remains tremendously low. Having lived in the city, having worked in city government at a time when we were depopulating and losing jobs, and thinking of New Jersey and Long Island as the enemy rather than part of an ecosystem, I think it is a good thing to see that we are growing. The beauty of the housing market is that the laws of supply and demand suggest that if apartments are sitting empty, one can look to a correction in asking prices or rental prices.
Next question. With cannabis legalization coming, how do you see the tax revenue as solving city transportation and other problems?
I'll leave that to the state legislature.
this question is, what are the main concerns in city planning besides transportation and housing? And I think we addressed one of them with climate change. Another one the audience member suggests is security. Any other priorities that are really front and center for your work?
I'll say, Alyssa, I'm really pleased that you mentioned security, because I don't think we should take it for granted. When we look at our thriving and growing city, the fact that we are a safe city is a very large part of it, and we should never take that for granted. The one other major item, though, that I would mention is jobs, because if one looks at the issue of housing affordability, one can solve it in two dimensions. One is the lowering the cost of housing, but the other is assuring that our residents have the skills to get jobs that allow them to occupy the housing. And so we are extraordinarily focused on facets of our zoning that are impediments to job creation.
I mean, I wanted to ask you, Sarah, from a preservation perspective, I mean, it's, you know, you are advancing preservation as a goal in its own right within planning, and it would be great to hear just a little bit about how you think about, you know, balancing out when, you know, whether it's in the context of rezoning or any other kind of advancement toward new development, new implementation of new technologies, how you look at factoring preservation into that so that it's not a zero-sum game, but it's a innovation and preservation equation.
And I think, yeah, and I do, as a preservationist, I do truly believe that one of the things that makes this city so special and a global destination is the historic fabric in connection with everything that's new and innovative. And so I think that we're always looking at new innovative approaches to adapting existing buildings. And, you know, and I, again, as I said before, working closely with city planning, we've been able to collaborate on planning and rezoning efforts for growth to ensure some preservation is included. And it is a balancing act. And I think it is about sort of finding the perfect opportunities. So, for example, in East Midtown, we worked very closely together very early on. We established a framework for identifying which were the most important resources to protect in that particular rezoning. There were already 38 landmarks within the area, so we identified three major periods of development, the sort of pre-Grand Central, the terminal city Grand Central period, and the post-Grand Central, which is post-World War II. And then we sort of looked at the buildings that were already landmarked and how they filled out those categories, the level of integrity, the level of significance. And then we looked at potential resources and we evaluated them for those very same reasons and sort of looked at what categories needed to be fully fleshed out to identify some potential opportunities. And we identified 12 properties, which we've successfully designated, bringing the total number of designated properties into the area up to 50. And so that was one component of what we did, working closely with city planning. But the other aspect of that rezoning was to allow for district-wide transfer of development rights to other areas within the area. And I think that that met both preservation and planning goals. It allowed for preservation of significant historic buildings that told the story of the different periods of development. The transfer of development right process ensures the long-term preservation of the landmarks. It provides relief for the property owners by allowing them to deposit their air rights somewhere else. And then also by having more landing sites, it allows for more growth in the neighborhood. So I think that's an example of how the two really could work very well together.
And I'll try to keep this brief. I mean, obviously, you could look at any agency at the city, and if there was an issue, you of course have a problem with the whole fabric of the city working. But I would just add to the examples of transit and housing, and the very important one of jobs and economic activity, and also including in that retail and shopping experiences that are important for local jobs. Through the lens of transit, when we look at where people are going, education is obviously critical. People are large number of students are taking the public transit to school every day, and that becomes an equity issue as well. And you hear stories about kids taking 2.5 hours each way to go from one part of Queens, Bronx Science. and you realize it really is an equity issue, and it's critical to the economic development of the city. And then the other is public spaces and parks, which it may feel sort of, you know, less critical, but in terms of quality of life and opening up spaces, I think that's one of the things that public transit is, you know, has worked to correct, where historically some public spaces were only accessible via automobile, via car, and so huge portions of the population couldn't go, you know, to the beach or to a very large park. So making sure that public transit creates that experience for everyone and shared public experiences in these spaces is critical.
Yeah, and I just want to follow up on two of the points back to the jobs. I think, you know, if I haven't been clear before, we are, you know, preservation does not freeze buildings in time, right? We approve change every single day. That's what we do, and we allow for buildings to adapt and grow and find new uses, and all of that creates jobs as well, and as well as new construction. So I think that contributes to the economic development. And then on the issue of equity, I think that's another important thing that we all are thinking about. And you know, from our perspective, I think we use data as another planning tool to look at where we have landmarks, where are areas that are less well represented. We want to make sure that we're identifying all of the communities that have contributed to the city and the diversity of the city. And that, so that data also works as a very important planning tool for us, and we can pull data from other agencies to do that, but we can also understand historic development patterns, demographic changes, as well as languages. So then we can start to address communities equitably through the information we get about languages.
Unfortunately, we are all out of time. So I want to thank our panelists, Sarah Carroll, Rachel Haot, Marisa Lago. Thank you so much for a great conversation.
Thank you.